Welcome to Self-Defense, Violence, and Delusion. I'm Ben Holman, the president of the Wichita State Atheists and Agnostics. And so I guess the first thing is, why is an atheist organization hosting a martial arts talk? And the reason is because martial arts actually, believe it or not, has a lot to do, has a lot of similarities with religion, a lot of the same methodologies, as you'll hear in some of what gets talked about tonight, faith-based beliefs, and cult-like mentality. So there's plenty to be skeptical of in martial arts, and it's a topic that's near and dear to me, and so here we are. I came across Matt Thornton's work through Sam Harris's blog. He's a well-known atheist writer and blogger, and he had alluded to some of Thornton's work in an essay that he had written on violence, and so I started checking out some of Thornton's YouTube videos and loved what he had to say, and much of what Matt had to say changed my own views on martial arts, and yeah, so without further ado, Matt Thornton.
Thank you.
So if you would just maybe tell us some about who you are and how you...
Sure. I'm a lifelong martial artist, was interested in it, like many of you probably, from the time I was a kid, which was back when the dinosaurs roamed the earth. And after I left the military, which would be the late 80s, I sought out more martial arts training, and I was looking for lack of a better word, I was looking for what works, for truth in fighting. That's what interested me. And because of that, I gravitated more towards boxing, and I liked the JKD Concepts idea because I liked Bruce Lee's idea of having to fight at all ranges. I've been beat up a couple times by wrestlers, and I understood the reality of needing to fight at all ranges. Started training JKD, started boxing, started teaching JKD, and then I ran across Hicks and Gracie. I'm actually trying to remember which came first, and I actually believe, to tell the story accurately, I ran across Fabio Santos first. And Fabio Santos was one of Hicks and Gracie's black belts, actually from Holmes Gracie, Hickson's adopted older brother. And this was before the UFC. Nobody knew really what Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu was. There had been a plate bar or a corian, that was about it. And so Fabio wasn't actually teaching. He was just building sailboats in Portland. And he received a call from Horian, who knew that the UFC was coming up and anticipated the fact that he was going to need coaches. And he said, get in shape. So Fabio put a classified ad in the newspaper, one of the little newspapers in Portland. But again, it's pre-internet days, but classified ad asking for people to come try and beat him up. And my buddy, who was a boxer as well, was like, yeah, we get beat up every day. We might as well get beat up and get $50. I think he was paying money for it. And the results were what you might think. Fabio turned out to be a really nice guy, but it was just body lock, takedown, mount, arm lock, body lock, takedown, mount, you roll, he chokes you. It was magic. So I took a few lessons from Fabio. Immediately I was hooked. In fact, I remember after my first private lesson with Fabio, he looked at me and he said, now you're hooked. And I didn't quite know exactly how profound that statement was at the time, but it was true. And I believe it was shortly after that I ran into Hickson. And again, people didn't really know who he was at the time. And it was a small seminar, which gives you an idea how long ago it was, probably 20 guys. They were all judo guys. And again, I was a boxer at the time, but judo guys and wrestlers still I found intimidating. She got the judo black belts, these big black judo black belts with the gnarly ears. And after I walked in late, I noticed what he was doing, and I realized he was Iron Manning. He was wrestling one after the other in a row, but he wasn't using his hands, and he was submitting them. And then he called me over and he said, I'll take out my hand for you, big man. He didn't need to, but. And I went back to the JKD school I was teaching at, and after this, it was almost like a come to Jesus experience, for lack of a better term, because everything I've been looking for in martial arts in terms of efficiency and the ability to beat up or manage, defend yourself against people bigger and stronger was there. Self-evidently there. And I went back and told my peers and the other coaches, and they just were not interested. They said, well, they'll never take us down. And they just had no idea. And so at that time, I decided I have to open up my own school. And I left to 30 minutes south to a place called Kaiser, which is in Salem. Opened up my first gym. The tiny school was, I don't even know how many square feet, but maybe an eighth of this room.
And how much BJJ experience did you have at that point?
I'd say maybe a year.
Okay.
A year. And that was the beginning of SPG. That point forward.
Awesome.
I should say, I always tell the story because people ask this story, how I got started in martial arts, and I wind up talking about Hickson. But my main coach, I've been a black belt now for 14 years. And I think I went from, Hickson gave me my blue belt, but from blue belt to black, I think it was another eight. So it was like 22 years until I was a blue belt. My coach for those 22 years was Chris Howard, who was one of the first American black belts who I met when I first went down as a blue belt to Los Angeles.
One of the Dirty Dozen?
Yes.
Okay.
So, yeah, definitely full credit to Chris. He's been my coach for over 20 years.
Okay, awesome. Now, somewhere along the line, you didn't just realize that BJJ was effective, but you realized something about the methodology. You realized that Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is special in a way that other martial arts are not.
Right.
And if you could elaborate on that.
Sure. I was fascinated, like I said, by true, things that are true. And I was so kind of tired of questions of whether this technique works or does this technique work. Or to explain it a different way, in the JKD world at the time, they had what they called JKD concepts. And the idea was you draw from different martial arts what worked and what didn't work. It was a slogan that Bruce Lee had stolen from Mao Zedong, like absorb what is useful, reject what is useless, and ask specifically what is your own, which is a good utilitarian slogan. But the problem with it is, it's like a buffet at a really restaurant filled with terrible junk food, because three quarters of what they're pulling from is coming from what I call delivery systems, which don't train in a functional way. And so the distinction between what works and what doesn't work it's not about the technique, because you can find a lot of, all of us that have done Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu know, you know, a traditional Japanese Jiu-Jitsu instructor will show you what you just taught them, maybe the Japanese name, but one of your white belts with 2 months will submit them over and over again. So it's not the technique, it's the training method. And the training method, rather than have to explain that whole epistemology over and over again, the meme that I would use for it is just say aliveness. And you know, aliveness exists in combat sports because combat sports by definition are meritocracies. And so in boxing and Muay Thai and wrestling and judo and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, there is this emphasis on aliveness against working against resisting opponents. And that is what separates what works and what doesn't work, not necessarily the technique.
Now, did you coin the term aliveness or did someone else?
I think the specific definition that I like to use, which is timing, energy, and motion, which is three definitions of the same thing, but you have to see all three sides of the object in order to play it well. I think, I don't remember when I came up with it, but I do believe I came up with that. But the word itself is aliveness. It's been used for a long time by many different people.
So you and your opinion and thesis about the subject of martial arts is that unless, you know, when we're talking about sort of the physical aspect of self-defense, and certainly the martial arts and how to fight someone, you're proposing that it's only the combat sports. So there's only a few delivery systems that are going to be worth messing around in and training in, and the others are just bogus. And
sure.
And it has to do with
the training method.
And that is that
epistemology.
Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu boxing has the self-correcting mechanisms,
which is aliveness.
Of the resistance.
Aliveness is the self-correcting mechanism of physical combat.
And I think a lot of people hear you talk like this, and they, of course, lots of objections in traditional martial artists start to come into their mind, and I think the first is, well, it's all fine and well to practice the sport, but that's not really preparing you for what a fight is going to be like.
Right.
And so, you know, traditional street fights are going to have or if there is a traditional street fights, that in the real world, real violence, you're going to be faced with multiple opponents. You're going to be faced with timing and a range that is not the same as in a sport scenario, which is to say that in the combat sports, you're beginning at a certain range. Both players know what's happening, and you begin when the bell rings, and there's also real fights are going to have the introduction of weapons, and so I think one of the first biggest criticisms is are you deluding yourself with certainly the combat sports are part of the story, but is it the whole story when it comes to self-defense?
Combat sports aren't the whole story, but the training method that combat sports use are the whole story. It's interesting because people will say, well, when the results matter in a wrestling mat, when the results matter in a boxing ring, the results matter in a cage, the results matter in a jiu-jitsu tournament, we're going to train this way because we know if we don't train this way, our students won't be able to go out there and compete. But if it's a guy with a knife who's trying to take my life, then we use the bullshit training method.
Right.
That's essentially the logic. And so, whether I'm working with police officers or I'm working with military operators or whoever I'm working with, the methodology we use is the same. The circumstances will dictate the tactics and plans change upon contact. And you have to have all kinds of different situational awareness. And if you're carrying a weapon like a police officer is, there's certain things you have to take into account as far as the positions you want to be in and not be in. But having said all that, if some big guy grabs you in a headlock and is holding you down in a parking lot out here, it doesn't matter that it's a parking lot. The escape, the structural escape, the position that allows you to have leverage over something bigger and stronger than you doesn't magically change because you're in front of Walmart instead of a mat.
Right.
And nor does the ability to knock somebody out, punch or an elbow or open a hand or whatever else it is. So the training methods we use all remain the same. I'll tell you one funny story that will illustrate my point. For years, I've had students come up and take private lessons from Los Angeles or different places, and they would normally take a train in something like Krav Maga, and they'd be getting ready for their test. And they have, I don't know much about the system, but at the upper levels, they have these instructor tests they have to take, and the test for the instructor test is very much like an MMA, with weapons and without, unless they have, it's full contact sort of test. And so they would come to me to train for it, and I would just say, well, what are the parameters of the test? I mean, what is it they're going to ask you to do? And I would set the test up, and we would go through it. And I would bring in, and these would be people that have been trained for years, and I would bring in one of my students, usually a blue belt, sometimes not even that. So somebody with less than 2 years training in the academy, and they would wipe the floor with this person in every aspect of that test. And they would be impressed, and they would train with us for a week or 2 weeks, and they would go back down, and they would ace the test, and they would send me an email or call me and tell me how excited they were they would ace the test. And that's all fantastic, but I keep thinking to myself, why on earth would you train that?
Yeah. Do you think there's any value in, it seems like a lot of these combative systems, and Krav Maga being one of them, that is more oriented, Krav Maga, for those, anybody who doesn't know, is sort of like a, like an Israeli, I guess at least advertised as like Israeli self-defense or what the Israeli
Israeli commando fighting.
Right. What they use. And so it's supposedly very street oriented. I mean, is there any value in that scenario based training of, well, somebody's gonna come up and shove you up against the wall and cuss at you, and or you're, you know, let's instead of training in the gym today on the mat, we're all gonna go to the park and train whatever. You know, it seems like there's plenty of those characters roaming around on the internet and advertising that, well, we have to train in the dark, or we have to change the training environment to sort of inoculate us to different things.
That's not the approach I would take. If somebody, and I do have a lot of students, you know, most of my students don't compete, right? So even the ones that train jiu-jitsu, they'll come in and say they want to, a lot of times they say they want to learn self-defense. And my approach for teaching people self-defense, which is what I've been working on the last couple of years with the book, is the way I would approach it, not that way. But having said that, what you're describing isn't necessarily bad, and there's no reason you can't take one of my students or any of the students from any functional martial arts school that trains, and some people here, and put them through those scenarios. But what you'll discover time and again when you do that is they do much better.
Right. Do much better than someone who's only training Krav Maga.
Yeah, the skill you have in the delivery system, whether it's stand-up clinch or ground, on the ground, and, you know, in the clinch as a wrestler or with striking, you carry that with you wherever you go. At all times, it's with you in your body. Nobody can take that away from you. So the tactics and strategies may change, and it's important to be aware of those if you're going to be carrying a firearm or being in a situation where those kind of things might come to play. But the functional skill that people develop over the years in the academy, that requires alignment.
You know, I've heard the objection a lot of, well, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu being an almost entirely ground-based system is diluting itself from the get-go by even just thinking that's where you want to be in a fight. So it's, you know, in the middle, when you are attacked at Walmart, you don't want to pull guard.
Right. But fights aren't about where you want to be. If you could choose where you wanted to be in a fight, it wouldn't be a fight.
Right.
Right? So all the time I talk to police officers who find themselves on the ground daily struggling with people that are trying to get control over. And you can be in a fight and have every intention in the world of staying on your feet and doing everything tactically smart, and 2 seconds later wind up on your back on the ground. And so you have to be able to defend yourself at all ranges. Because someone is skilled there, means they're far more likely to be able to stand back up and get away than somebody that's just going to thrash about like a fish out of water.
Yeah, yeah. I think the light bulb moment for me is, I think I had read something of yours where you had said that, ironically, the best way to really stay on your feet and to, you know, to even avoid being taken down, you have to train the grappling
Absolutely.
Systems.
Absolutely. Who are the hardest people in the world to get to the ground? Wrestlers. Are not the hardest people in the world. We all know it's true. Any wrestling team in the world, they don't even go to the wrestling team and try and take them down. It's like a verifiable, repeatable experiment. So it's not the Hapkido guys or the street guys that are hard to take down.
Do you think when we're training in a sport like setting, you know, is it worthwhile to remind people that, now remember, eye gouges and biting and
I think it's,
those things
there's
are reality.
A certain value to mentioning those things. I do really enjoy what we call my school, we call it polytudo, the old school jiu-jitsu, where, and we probably, in my class, we probably do it maybe once a week, where the students are allowed to kind of playfully slap and punch each other while we roll. And I think that's good for people's jiu-jitsu because it brings it back to the fundamentals of what actually works in a fight. And that's, to be honest with you, for most people, that's really all you need is to feel comfortable down there when somebody's hitting us, is to have a little practice at that.
How much jiu-jitsu would you say has to be, how much of it has to be modified for really engaging someone in a fight, as far as when?
That depends on the type of curriculum. So, you know, one of our core philosophies, we have a few basic principles that kind of all the different SPGs that you would visit would adhere to, and one of them is emphasis on fundamentals. And this is one of those concepts I think so many people misunderstand, and I blame myself because obviously I haven't explained it well enough yet, but when I say fundamental, I'm not talking about a basic technique, like something necessarily that you learn the first day, though it often is. When I say fundamental, I'm talking about something that everybody needs to know how to do. Everybody's going to do more or less the same way, and is a core piece of the delivery system. And those fundamentals transcend environment. By definition, they transcend time, they transcend environment, they transcend venue, they transcend bodies, and they transcend style. So the core fundamentals for escaping the mount don't really change when we switch from MMA to gi to no gi to insert here, or headlock escape. You know, the principles that make the one human body be able to escape from another human body who's strong and aggressive, those principles remain the same throughout those different environments. They're the same for a 110-pound woman as they are for someone my size. And those principles are what I like to teach. And my working thesis has always been for 20 years is that if I only teach those fundamentals, a variety of species, for lack of a better term, will evolve naturally on the mat. And every single player, by the time they get to be purple belt to brown belt, will be very different. And that has been my experience. So by contrast, when I visited schools where they teach a great technique by technique basis, what the instructor tends to be good at is what they teach. You have a bunch of students who tend to try and use the same sweep, use the same guard pass, and it's very much more of a style. And so what I like to do is I like to just teach the fundamentals. And this is true. When I say Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, I could just as easily be talking about MMA or self-defense curriculum. But I like to teach just the fundamentals and then create a healthy and safe environment where people can get together and through a live training to develop their own style. And that style is going to be different for everybody.
Now, I think some people, when they hear you talk about aliveness, they immediately have in mind 100% resistance from the beginning, from day one. And
couldn't be more wrong. So aliveness is timing, energy, and motion. So that if it's in a predictable pattern, it's not alive. If it's not done with a resistance that would mimic the resistance that you would actually get. So for example, if I'm swinging a stick and I lock my arm out, nobody swings a stick that way, so it's the wrong level of resistance. And motion, just motion on the ground, motion standing, unpatterned movement that occurs when two people are not cooperating with each other. Anything that follows those guidelines will help you acquire timing, and timing is what separates a black belt from a white belt. I remember when I was a new white belt, I think it was blue or purple, there was a video that came out of Hickson that showed up at Torrance Academy one day. I'm sure all the jiu-jitsu people in here have probably seen this video, but he showed up at Torrance Academy one day in like swim trunks and Iron Man, you know, half the room was there. And then at the end, the guy has the camera on him, he's talking to him about jiu-jitsu, and Hickson explains jiu-jitsu is about timing. It's knowledge of technique, but it's timing. And then he explains that methodology using the analogy of the triangle. And it made crystal clear sense to me at the time that that's really what it's all about. And so as long as the timing is there, what you get will translate directly into full contact. And I think people will be very surprised. It's one thing for me to say it. It's another thing for me to have produced a bunch of students around the world that can do it. And it's another thing now, some of my black belts have produced some of the best fighters in the world that do it. But I think most people would be very surprised to see how someone like Conor McGregor trains, because he very rarely is there going to be a lot of head trauma. We're very concerned about that because of brain damage. But also, it's just totally unnecessary. It's totally unnecessary. So the people who say that what we do is too rough just don't understand what we do.
Can you elaborate a little bit more of how most traditional martial arts rely on sort of this pantomime fighting?
Sure, it's a pattern. So it's choreography. One person attacks, other person responds. And the theory is, if you do that long enough, like if you just put in 10,000 reps, you'll eventually get the timing, you'll be good. But you'll never get the timing because it's a fixed pattern. And fights don't occur in a fixed pattern. The analogy I often use is tennis. If you wanted to work your backhand, I could have you go in the garage, give you a racket, or maybe not even a racket, but just make a cotton, visible racket. And you do 1,000 repetitions of the backhand every morning in the garage. Let's say we have two genetically identical twins. And for 1 year, I have one twin do that every morning for an hour. And I take the other twin, and for 1 hour total, I slowly lob tennis balls at him on a tennis court. And he hits it back with a backhand. And sometimes he misses, and as he gets a little bit better, I hit the ball a little bit harder. And we're moving around, I'm throwing the ball. And I'll take the one twin that's got maybe 2 hours of that over the other twin that's got a year of repetitions in the garage, and guarantee you that the twin that I've been working with aliveness, is going to have a better backhand.
Now, so then another thing that comes to mind is, what if, you know, an Aikido instructor or a CMOD instructor said, okay, well, we take your point, aliveness needs to happen, so we're going to just train CLOT alive. It seems like you think that that's not possible.
No, you can totally do that. And after 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 years, insert how many years you want like this, you will evolve something that looks like MMA and have reinvented the wheel, which is a total waste of time, but everybody's free to do that. if you put two CELOC people in a cage and have them fight under MMA rules, or have two people trying to fight MMA that don't know how to fight, it's going to look like exactly what it would look like if we took two amateurs. So amateurs might do better.
So you're saying they're fancy sweeps and the hand trapping and everything that is the things that would be sort of single out their system as their system would then disappear, and it would just look like two people grappling who just have never had any experience grappling.
Right. One of my good friends, another black belt from Korea, John Franklin, has a good way to say it. I'm sure most of you have heard before, but Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is always, in retrospect, it's always common sense. When you see good Jiu-Jitsu and somebody shows you a solution to a physical problem on the mat, and you just go, why didn't I think of that? That's the best stuff in Jiu-Jitsu, but it's always common sense and hindsight. Now, if you're really bright and you understand the mechanics of how it works when two bodies are going at it on the ground, theoretically, you could sit in a closet and come up with it after 75 years, but why not take advantage of the professors who already have the training and then build upon their knowledge like we do with everything else?
Right. What do you think about multiple attacker training? You see this in Aikido, does it, and I think they call it Randori, and then different, of course, like Krav Maga. I think, you know, some of the reality-based self-defense systems, they try to push this, is because in real life, you very well could be faced with multiple attackers. So does it not make sense to somehow, train that and prepare yourself for should the day come?
Sure, you can practice with multiple opponents, and the need to have real skill in what I'm talking about is going to become even more important. And in fact, the first thing that people are going to recognize they need is to be in shape. Just being in physical condition is more important. When I talk about self-defense with people, let me rephrase it. When I see someone who is, let's morbidly obese, or let's say 70 or 80 pounds overweight, in camouflage fatigue with three training knives on them, and they're reading a Soldier Fortune magazine and wondering which caliber handgun they need to use, I'll ask them. Using an extreme analogy, but these people do exist. Now, why are you training, right? And the answer is always, well, I want to be able to defend myself. So, why do you want to defend yourself? And then, what do you mean, why do I want? Well, why do you want to defend yourself? Well, so I can go home to my family. Well, then why are you 7 pounds overweight? Why aren't you wearing your seatbelt? I mean, half of this room is going to die of heart disease and cancer, 51%.
Right.
The rest will most likely die of diabetes. The shootings, as bad as they are, they're horrible, are down 50% from what they were in the 90s. All crime is on a rapid decline, especially in the Western world. And if you were really sincere about self-preservation, the first thing people would do is they'd be in shape and take care of their bodies. So let's start there. There's a reason why every military force in the world has put conditioning as a priority.
Sure. And of course, some of that is, we're just good at partitioning different sections of our brain, and they're not maybe thinking about it.
Really, it's what it gets down to is that those people who are attracted to fighting for the wrong reasons, it becomes something immature. They're not sincere.
That if they were truly training to have to fight, that they would be in shape.
They would focus on being in shape. They would be training hard and doing all those things.
You had mentioned boxing and the TBI, which is a traumatic brain injury. It seems like we want boxing, we want the hand movements and the striking of boxing and Muay Thai for a complete physical aspect of self-defense. We want those strikes in our arsenal, but how do we justify, it seems like the irony is, well, to get good at defending ourselves, we have to train in something that's going to damage our brains.
Right.
So where's the balance there?
There are really good stand-up coaches, and there's more and more. They're in high demand right now, but who can teach people and get people relatively good without incurring much risk of brain damage. And those are the people that we need to train with. And in sport, boxing is horrible. I love boxing. It's just brutal, as is American football. And with MMA, sometimes it can also be bad. It's obviously better because we can clinch and take it to the ground, and we don't have to stand there and punch somebody in the face. And my first, the first thing I'd like to see happen, which is not going to happen, so it's kind of a pipe dream, but I'd like to see him get rid of the gloves.
Yeah.
As soon as we get rid of the gloves, a lot of the brain damage will go down and people will start striking in a slightly different manner because they don't want to break their hands. And I think it'll just be better. What the gloves do is they just make it more damaging for the skull.
Right.
Which is totally counterproductive.
And by removing the gloves, also making it more realistic to what it's really going to be in the...
Yeah, I mean, sure.
It has that added benefit.
It has that added benefit, yeah. But definitely for the head trauma, I'd like to see that happen. I don't think it will happen, but just because of public relations. But to answer your question, you can develop fairly good functional skill in striking without having to get in there and really put your brain at a lot of risk. You just have to find the right coaches.
Do 10-week self-defense courses, do they have value? Is there, if you see, advertised women's self-defense or just whatever these classes are, let's say if they even are using alive methods, it seems to me that if you really care about taking self-defense seriously, it's going to have to be trained like a sport consistently.
Right.
And so...
No. I mean, I hesitate to answer that. As I normally see them being taught, if the course that we're talking about is a course where people are mostly educated about the nature of real-world threats, I think absolutely, because the majority of what's going to keep someone safe in terms of crime, violent crime, has nothing to do with fighting. I mean, most people in this room have no reason to get into a fight. If you get into a fight, it's probably your fault.
Right.
And we have in our mind a kind of an idea of violent attackers occurring from strangers with ski masks and parking lots that are closer to my age, and that's just not reality. Most violence in this country is perpetrated by people you know. 80% of women that are killed by their husband or their boyfriend. Half are killed by their husband. Another third are killed by their boyfriend or date. Half of those report being stalked. So you only have 20% out of the total homicides against women that aren't someone they're dating or married to. And you can see that reflected the same with the male-on-male violence. So, and most of it is young men between the ages of 15 and 22, which is the highest risk category for violence. Most all that, it's the largest category for violence. And the rest, almost all of it, falls under young males under the age of 35. So violence is primarily a male problem, male issue, problematic violence. And it primarily occurs with young men, and almost all of it occurs with men under the age of 35. And knowing what to look for, knowing what to be aware of, knowing how to spot those people, those situations, avoid those situations, understanding just practical, basic things of what you should do, I think in today's modern society is more than enough to keep most people safe. Add on top of that some sort of conditioning program. I think Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is great as well, because if it does turn physical, especially for women, it's usually going to be physical on the ground with somebody grabbing you, but even with men, it most often is. And there's something that happens to students. I've seen it happen to, obviously over the years, I've had lots of women who were rape victims. I've had men come to me that were claustrophobic. I've had lots of people come through the gym. I'm sure the other coaches here have as well. And you can see the change in their confidence, real confidence. Not confidence that's based on a false sense of knowledge because they think they can beat up someone because they trained Israeli commando tactics for 10 days.
Right.
But confidence in being able to feel their body and where it's at in position to another human body, what it feels like to have somebody really trying to hold you down or really trying to choke you. And they've experienced that in an environment where they were safe, so they were allowed to experience it. And that, combined with knowledge, is going to keep people safe.
So how much, when we're talking about self-defense, when we're talking about the whole picture of self-defense, how much is the physical martial art training, what percentage do you put that in?
If you came to me and said, Matt, my sole purpose is self-defense, I'm not interested in, fighting or jiu-jitsu or anything like that, then we don't need to train martial arts. I think anybody who really studied the data about problematic violence and has has not concluded that it's a problem related to maturity of males, hasn't understood the data. So once we get that and we start to work in that area, and then we move into the next area, which is being intelligent about how you handle situations. You know, understanding the distinction between how someone you initiate contact with and somebody that initiates contact with you, right? Penn has a, you know, for Penn and Teller has a really good way of saying this. But it's the same thing for Connor. He's a Connor was back in the day, but he said, you know, most people are good people, which is absolutely true. And he would, you know, walk into a Starbucks and throw his keys into the middle of the Starbucks and say, you know, my wife's pregnant, I've got to jump in the ambulance and be part of the car for me. Almost guaranteed that when you come back, that car's going to be parked there. I mean, somebody might be like, oh, fuck, car. But your car will be parked there and the keys will probably be with the barista. But if someone comes to you and initiates contact with you and says, hey, man, can I have the keys to your car? That's a whole different thing. So yeah. Understanding, you know, how people are approaching you and why they're approaching you and what their demeanor is, and that's the next piece of the puzzle. And then once we get past that, then really it's a question of not having people make sure people don't pick you. Because predators pick their prey, and they pick, you know, weakness is provocative, so they pick men and women that look like they're vulnerable. Like they're not going to be assertive. You know, teaching people just to be assertive, male or female, in a relational context is absolutely critical, far more critical than being able to fight. You know, just give you a point on that. I know one of my friends, she's a beautiful woman, single, and when I used to live in the worst neighborhood, which is not a neighborhood that I would walk around with my kids in that neighborhood when I lived there, I would see her take a walk, and she'd just walk, and she liked to walk in the morning, and nobody ever gave her a hard time. And part of it was her gait, and part of it was her sense of confidence when she walked. And part of it was how she would retort when somebody slowed their car down and said something obnoxious to her. But that's what kept her safe. She didn't train with me. She was not a fight, but it was her demeanor being assertive that is what stops me.
So is that really what it comes down to at the end of the day, of just recognizing the difference between social violence and predator violence?
Right.
And then
it's all throwing predator violence.
It's all predator violence.
Yeah, because you know, people will worm their way into your life. I call them character disordered people because I don't like to make excuses for their behavior. Some people just have bad character. But they will come into people's lives and they will continually push the boundaries to see how far they can push them before the other person reacts back, and then it will turn violent. And then you'll all of a sudden realize, oh, you're dealing with a violent criminal actor. But very rarely does a violent criminal actor all of a sudden go, hey, I'm a violent criminal actor. You know, even in home invasions, most of the time it's somebody knocks on the door, rings the doorbell. Who answers the door? Is it an older woman that doesn't look like she can defend herself? Is she confused? Does she invite you in? Is there somebody else in the house? Do they have a screen door? Is there an alarm? You know, they're making all these assessments. They're profiling, which is what predators do. And if they think that she's weak enough, they'll attack her. But that's not somebody that almost, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but that's not somebody who just walks up to the door and starts kicking it in and runs in with a gun and points a gun at your head. It's not how violence works.
So, I mean, to gain some of the worthwhile knowledge, I mean, is it just, you just have to pay attention to how crime is happening in the news? Or, I mean where do we learn this if we're not? If we're not getting this in our Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu classes, and we're not getting this from our fathers who, you know, walked out when we were two. where are we learning? Where can we learn this information?
Everybody has to buy my book.
Yeah.
But when I started writing the book, I spent a couple of years and I read everything on the market that I thought might be what I want to say, just to make sure somebody hadn't said it before. I was somewhat relieved that they hadn't, and somewhat disturbed by most of what I read, and so much of it was so bad. But there are some good books on the market, and I always recommend to people Gavin Becker's work.
Okay.
Especially if you're a parent. He wrote one called Protecting the Gift, which is fantastic. Pretty much all you need, I think, to protect your kids. But his first book, The Gift of Fear, I think is mandatory reading for anybody sincerely interested in self-defense. And the premise is very simple. It's, we're the product of millions of years of evolution. Our ancestors got here because many of them were good at homicide. And all of them were pretty good at picking out predators. And we have that within us and have that instinct. Those, I call them primal instincts, are within everyone, but they so often get ignored, especially, I don't want to paint too broad a brush, but it seems to happen more often with women than men just because they're nicer, but they don't want to be rude, or you don't want to, you know, you don't, it's mostly just people don't want to be rude, and then it's too late. But what Gavin's work does is it shows that time and time again you have victims of criminal attacks, and at first their response when they're being interviewed is, it always appears sudden to them. It's like all of a sudden he was forcing me into the car or whatever it was. And, but when you ask them the right questions and sit down with them for a while, you realize almost every single time, there was a long series of events, or a series of events that began quite a bit, quite some time before it turned physical, that went ignored. They went ignored for sometimes good intentions, people not wanting to appear rude, people not wanting to say no, people not wanting to, again, be assertive and establish the boundaries. And learning to recognize those instincts and trust them. No, just to give you an example, I was giving a talk like this one on skepticism in Portland a few years ago. My daughter at the time, I think she was, I'll say maybe she's six now, she's probably three. And it was really crowded pub. And my wife was sitting there next to my daughter, and it was some stranger, a man was sitting next to my daughter on the other side. And at some point during the, during the talk, he put his hand on her shoulder or on her arm, and she looked at him, she said, "Don't touch me." And he was kind of taken aback, and I was watching what was going on, so I could see my wife was sitting right there. That's perfect. And the last thing I want to do to my daughter is tell her not to say that. He should then keep his hands to himself, and that's fantastic. So I want to nurture those instincts in her so that she feels comfortable. She had a feeling. She don't want to be touched by that guy, so don't touch me. And teaching people from a very early age, or when they come to you, to honor those boundaries is critical.
Would you say that the most important principle of self-defense, when we're talking about when the shit has really hit the fan of home invasion, the worst of the worst kind of stuff, active shooter, that the principle for almost, or really just for any self-defense kind of physical encounter at all, that is escape. Just escape, escape, escape.
Yeah. Maturity is the single most important thing as it relates to self-defense. That's followed by intelligence. And once we get those two things covered, then we're talking about noticing what's going on around you. And it's there, you can be aware, just being generally aware of your surroundings at any given time is good. But also, if you're not educated on what to be aware for, you might be generally aware of your surroundings, but you can't predict a particular event because you don't have enough information. So that's where the education comes in. So as long as you're educated as to what you should look for, because what we're looking for ultimately is some level of predictability. Once we get past that, so now we're mature, intelligent, and we're noticing what's going on around you, then it's what I call the three Ds. And the first one's deterrence, and that's just your demeanor and how you handle things, and not being someone that predators thin slice, that they just pick. I mean, they will pick. Carjackers will sit there and they'll watch one car. And then the one, they know which one to get. And you can interview them and try and figure out exactly how they make their assessment, but it's very primal. Many of them can't tell you how they make their assessment. They just know which gazelles to go after, right? So deterrence, and then it's distance management. Whether we're talking about the military or fight, it's distance management. Managing your distance to the threat. Once it becomes physical, that's what the fight is all about. Managing distance between you and that other person, whether they have a weapon or not, is what fights, what handling fights intelligently is. And determination. But, number one, you should always fight before you ever capitulate, but only every single time. And number two, you're going to fight. You're going to go along with your family, no matter what. You're going to fight. But that's, I want to stress again, we're living in this safest time. None of our ancestors have ever lived in a time that was as safe as we sitting here today, unless you guys are about to ship off to Syria or the Congo or something.
Right.
And we living here today.
Or New Orleans.
Yeah. That's just a very, that's the worst case for a tiny minority. Just to give you one more example of kidnappings. with children. I mean, as a parent, that's everybody's worst nightmare, obviously. It's a horrible nightmare. And as a child that grew up in the 70s, I was under the impression kids got kidnapped all the time because of milk cartons, right? Pictures of kids in milk cartons. But the problem with the milk cartons is nobody ever differentiated between who stole the kid. Like, there's a very tiny percentage of children that are stolen by strangers. Most all kids that reported missing show up, and it was a miscommunication between them and their parents or guardians. Almost, that's the majority of it. The rest of it, where they actually were taken by somebody, they were taken by a parent in a dispute. Step parent or mom or something in a divorce dispute. So out of all the missing kids in this country that go missing every year, less than 100 on average are taken by strangers. That's horrible, but it's in a country of 322 million people, and it's less than 100, of which half will be killed. So about 50 kids are killed a year. That's very bad, but it's not that, it's not on those milk cartons.
That's an interesting point, because a lot of people, I think, do have the perception that violence is on the rise, and I mean, I think really just throughout all of history, everyone thinks it's getting worse. Violence is on the rise. We have to be vigilant. Certainly, recently, seems like gun violence is an issue. And even just yesterday, we had another case of a mass shooting. Is this something we need to be worried about? Is this something we need to
mass shootings?
Or just gun violence in general, the mass shootings in particular? How do we prepare ourselves for that without being paranoid? And
the thing I don't think the majority of people who haven't studied the topic probably don't realize is that if you take certain neighborhoods out of the data, and these are neighborhoods where gang-related violence occurs on a daily basis, gun violence in the United States looks very similar to Canada. That's not what you get from the media. But the vast majority of shootings in this country are gang-related violence. And those aren't even disputes over, a drug deal gone wrong. They're trivial, petty arguments over status between young males who don't have fathers. And that's the majority of all gun violence in this country. Now, I'm not saying, I'm not staking any position as it relates to gun laws. I'm not going to go there, except to say that people should take it very seriously when you're contemplating taking away someone else's right to defend themselves. So, that needs to be taken seriously. But there's no need to be paranoid if you don't fall into that category. There have been a lot of shootings. When I looked at the data, it's been a year since I looked at it, we weren't that far off from other places. This year, that might be different. But let's say there was one a day this year. We still live in a country of 322 million people. So, I mean, you're far more likely you're going to walk back to your car tonight, your heart's going to explode, and then you're going to be involved in a mass shooting. So, I don't want to make light of it or say it's not something people should take seriously, but I wonder sometimes how much the more dangerous the stress is from watching the news every day than as opposed to the actual thing.
Should we be teaching our children and our teachers how to respond in these kind of
absolutely. School shootings, airline hijackings, things like that, to me, those are very simple problems, to be honest with you. We took care of airline hijackings very early on, and it's not arming the pilots. It's reinforcing the doors and changing the habits of the flight attendants so that people don't have access to the cockpit. And that was done very quickly. So all those doors tend to be reinforced, especially on the overseas flights. And you'll notice if you fly as much as I do, and many of you, they have a whole protocol when the pilot has to come out. And flight attendants aren't going back and forth giving coffee or anything like that. So there's no access to the cockpit. With a school shooting, it's about how people get in. And once they're in, if we were really serious about controlling school shootings, then we'd have limited access points for entry. That's what you do. And Columbine, my friends was talking about this the other day, Ray Price, who actually is a police officer that works in schools. And I don't know if people realize this or not, but those boys in Columbine, they had two duffel bags, like military-style duffel bags. Those were about the size of a heavy bag, right? Like 6 foot tall, filled with explosives.
Yeah.
That they dragged into where I think it was the cafeteria or something, and fortunately they didn't go off because the casualties would be much higher. But here's the thing is, those kids dragged two body-sized duffel bags through the school dressed in trench coats. And before anybody identified what was going on. So you control the access of entry. And then the second thing is, you know, the doors, the exit doors shouldn't open from the outside. And then if a school shooter comes in, the teachers need to lock the door. You know, predators go after easy prey. They're going to go like this. They're going to shake the doorknob, and they're going to move to the one that's open.
Do you think, do you think that the typical protocol of, well, we're just going to lock the door and I'll huddle in the corner? Or I feel like if I was in one of those classes, I would be going out the window and just leaving my classmates behind.
They may not know where the shooter is. The teacher may not feel comfortable sending a bunch of six-year-olds out of the window or whatever. But locking the door and making sure we know who enters the school. It should be hard for a grown adult to enter a school without having contact with a teacher before he gets access to children, period. Forget about school shootings, that just should be hard. Now, if that's not hard to do, if I could walk into fifth grade school through a back door and go have a conversation with a kid in the lunchroom before a teacher has recognized that I've entered the area, then you have a larger security problem that needs to be addressed. That would in and of itself cover most of the school shootings.
But a lot of these are happening on college campuses, yes, where everyone is an adult.
Right.
So it's, and there's, you know, there's multiple buildings. I mean, you know, we're not going to know until they, you know, display their weapon and start firing, you know, what the heck's going on. So I mean, what in the college scenario, do we just kind of hope for that we are land on the better side of the statistics, or is there anything we could do to, you know, sort of?
You know, just circumstances have to dictate the tactics there. But people will respond differently. I wouldn't want to judge someone in those situations based on how they responded. Some people will freeze, and that's not a choice. And other people will run, and they will respond. You get somebody in charges these guys and takes them down. And that's fantastic, and we all rightfully call them a hero. But I'm not so sure if we had three individuals and each one responded in each of those different ways, that any of them really had much of a choice, because in those kind of situations, the body tends to just respond as it does. If you were asking me what I would prefer to see people do, if you can't run away, charge. Don't just cover up and hope for the best.
Right.
But again,
nobody wants to be the first one.
Right.
First guy's taking that bullet.
Right.
So yeah, what do you think about these people who say they can teach gun disarms? Is that
guns real? Are not magic fire sticks. Like a lot of people, I run into this sometimes. Some of my good friends are police officers that work. That would be the first people to tell you this, but sometimes especially some of the older officers have a tendency to move to the weapon too soon before they need to, and a lot of that has to do with the fact that they don't train. I'll tell you a funny story. I had one of my students who's an older guy. I want to say he was probably 45, 46. He had like six kids, police officer, kind of chubby. He was probably 5'6", maybe 200 pounds, something like that. Not a big guy, a small guy. But he trained jiu-jitsu with me, and I think before he moved to Las Vegas, he was a purple belt. Because he had like 5 or 6 years of training. And he worked on Portland PD, and every time they would have some crazy guy naked running through the street or something like that, you'd have these officers my size, like 6'4", 240-pound officers, and like, call Chad. So they call the 5'6", 200-pound, like kind of out-of-shape guy, and he would come and just deal with the guy. He would just use his jiu-jitsu and control the guy and put him on the phone. I'm like, really? Is that like what you guys include? Maybe you should be trying something else. So anyway, to answer your question, again, that's about distance management. When you're trying to take away a gun, it's not so much what you do with your hands in terms of how you hold the gun or strip it or anything like that, as it does forward pressure and taking the barrel offline. Once the barrel's offline, it's not a threat.
So you're saying not a total waste of time for those who sit right. But you have to find somebody who is really delivering the goods.
Like anything else, it has to be drilled a lot. If you can drill the weapon, disarms them.
With a round in the chamber, it has to be drilled a lot.
Not that way. You can use a water bottle.
Yeah.
It has to be drained a lot.
How do we differentiate? I mean, I certainly agree with much of what you've said, probably all of what you've said, but your thesis, how do we, when you're talking about aliveness in martial arts, it's all very philosophical to a point until we take it, you know, we take it out and we test it, and then, you know, we add that science element to it, which the UFC is the best example of. But it seems like the UFC has still, somehow that allows people to still not make the link that the other traditional martial arts are useless. And I mean, what's missing there? I mean, is it that it's not explicit? Is it that everybody's just doing boxing, wrestling, Brazilian jiu-jitsu? And do you sort of see what I'm saying? That it seems like the Aikido guys haven't got the message that their takedowns are worse than wrestlers.
Right.
And is it because it hasn't just been an explicit takedown contest? It's been a fight, and because it's been a broader exercise, that's allowed the conclusion to be avoided.
You know, it really depends. So you have some people who train in those martial arts who truly don't know. Right? They really don't know. And a good example is when I give my skepticism lecture in Portland. We show some videos beforehand, and there's a video we use of the Japanese guy. No touch knockout guy. Mm-hmm. Challenge the MMA guy to come and gets punched in the face. You can see him look at his nose and just amazed that he was punched in the face. So the fact that he was, I think he put up $5,000 of his own money or something like that. He put up his own money, brought all the students, and actually stepped to fight
a boxer,
an MMA fighter, shows that he was completely delusional. But more often than not, these people aren't going to show up. They're going to avoid the laboratory. And so what that tells you is they're insincere. And a science is, as a method, reason is a method, aliveness is a method, any epistemology is a technique. You can teach anyone a technique. I mean, I can teach anyone here 20 minutes how to train anything with aliveness. I can give you the formula for how we do it. And anyone can be educated in the physical sciences and learn how to run experiments and use the scientific method. But if you're not sincere, in other words, more interested in the truth than you are in what you want to be true, and it won't matter. And we see that in sciences, and we see that everywhere else. And you know, if you don't get the conclusion you want, you just ignore it.
Right.
And move on. Well, that's not fixable. That's an attitude, it's a disposition. So the best we can do, I think, is model it and to other people. And explain why I think it's healthy to be that way, but I can't gift people with it.
If you were presented with evidence or data that Kung Fu, you know, Wing Chun, really helped kids defend themselves, and something like if we taught a bunch of kids the Si Lim Tao, and somehow this helped them in dealing with conflict resolution and even fighting,
right.
Would you change your mind?
Sure. Yeah. I eagerly await those results. I'm skeptical, but I'm always open to contrary evidence.
Excellent. Well, I think I might turn it over to the audience and see if anybody's got questions for you.
So, ladies and gents, what we'll do is, if anybody's got a question, just throw a hand up and I'll bring the mic over. I'll go ahead and hold on to it. We've had some experiences in the past where people get pretty ranty.
But yeah, I mean, I guess any question about violence, self-defense, martial arts?
I think you or someone on your site has written about this, but I forgot the answer. How do they coexist, or is there a conflict between like Bruce's idea of take what's useful and start the rest and the jiu-jitsu belt system in your school?
Yeah, I've never really compared those two things before, to be honest with you. I think that what Bruce Lee advocated for is what we do. Mm-hmm. That's my opinion. The belt system, as far as how I view the belts, is just pure meritocracy. So in my gym, if somebody can technically perform and occasionally win, hold their own with the other blue belts, they're a blue belt. their students know they're a blue belt, and they're going to, everybody's going to want me to belt them, because nobody, no blue belt wants to get tapped out by a white belt. And eventually the day will come, and I'll just call up in front of the class, and they wrestle with the whole class, and they hand them the belt. And that's how you do it. And it's the same for every belt. And that's why the belts in jiu-jitsu are meaningful, is because they're just symbolic of a physical skill that can't be faked any more than you can fake being able to speak French or play the guitar, right? And so it means something to that degree. So that would be my answer for you.
We kind of interviewed you talking about other martial arts and if they're useless or any benefit to them. Would any martial art where you're sparring benefit somebody who's in a confrontation with somebody who's never done this sort of activity? Or is it someone, even with the aspects of sparring and training like that?
Well, let's think about it this way. Can someone pull off a Taekwondo kick in MMA? Absolutely. So Conor McGregor can go learn, train the Taekwondo person, learn a kick, and we'll probably go out and hit, knock out Jose Aldo next weekend, right? For sure. But Conor McGregor has, embodies the delivery systems. He has the root skill in all the delivery systems that he's trained for, you know, the last 15 years of his life. What if we took someone training Taekwondo, preparing for the Olympics, and all they did was that kind of sparring where they have their hands down on their sides? Could that be counterproductive in an actual fight? Absolutely. So, you know, there are certain things that could be full contact that actually could develop bad habits. Even with jiu-jitsu, I think sometimes I remind my instructors when they're teaching class, the order in which you teach things can become important, because you can actually develop bad habits with the students, because if they don't know anything else, they're going to do the moves in the order that you teach them. So if you're teaching them a move that's late, very late, then they're going to wait until the submission or the position is established to that point before they begin working their counter, because that's all they know. And in a sense, that's your fault, because you didn't show them, well, first I want you to do this, and then this, and then this, and prioritize it. That's a more general example, but when we really mess with the rules and say, you hold your hands down by your side, you can only use your feet, then you can definitely develop bad habits.
You kind of answered the question about like sport versus a realistic situation. But as far as kind of go back to your comment about fundamentals, is it more about teaching like a principle versus an actual technique, and the technique is just a result of the principle? I mean, is that where it's kind of a blend of the two, you know, versus like high repetition training versus, you know, your aliveness training? I mean, is it more of a gray area, blend of the two, or is it more just one than the other?
See if I understand your question correctly. Are you asking about high repetitions, or are you asking?
High repetitions within the realm of your aliveness concept.
Problem with high repetitions is they're really boring.
Yeah.
They're
yeah.
So boring. I would never do that. So I hate to put my students through it. That's number one. Number two is because they're so boring, more often than not, people start to get sloppy. Right? The more reps they do, the worse the reps get. So then, in a sense, it becomes counterproductive. And then the third problem is there's no timing. Like, the repetitions will teach you how to do the movement correctly, and repeating repetitions can, to a certain degree, develop smoother routes in terms of economy of motion. So it might be slightly more quicker on the movement speed, but there's no timing. And so what we want to do is we want to teach the movement and have them repeat it only to the point where they can show me without resistance that they can do it properly. So, you know, the student can demonstrate the movement without resistance, and they can do it properly. Once I see that, and for most people, that takes 5 to 6 minutes, maybe 10 minutes. If it takes longer than that, then what I'm teaching is probably too complicated for the class, or we break it into parts. Now, once I see that, 5 or 6 minutes, now we drill it live. And the art becomes creating drills on the spot where people can resist with each other without injuring each other, but develop timing. And the bulk of the class will be that. And then at the end, we put it all back together in the whole, whatever they're working on. So if it's jiu-jitsu, then in a gi match or whatever the situation is, so that they have context for it. So we introduce the movement, then we isolate it. The isolation portion always follows introduction, and it always has resistance once they've been at the gym for, you know, 5 or 6 weeks in their sparring. And then we roll at the end. So that would be the methodology we use.
Okay.
Make sense?
And I have plenty. there's a lot of ways that we're talking about, like I guess like a fight, like a one person fighting another person. That's one type of violence that we talk about. There's a lot of ways you could win that confrontation and still come out a loser. You can get sued, you can end up in jail, you can get fired, your family might look at you differently. There's a lot of ways to lose that situation. So even if you know, like, I don't know how you would, but if you're confident that you would come out on top, what is going in your head, like, I should go ahead and start this before he starts it? You know, like, does that make sense? Like, what should be the trigger?
When would you initiate contact?
Yeah.
The moment you think it's inevitable and you can't get away. You know, and you should be prepared to have to explain that to an attorney, who will then explain it to a judge and the police officers.
So what would be an appropriate, I mean, like, are you literally in the corner, or are they somebody just asking you for your blood, or is, or, you know what I mean? Like, what's the appropriate really way to reason to fight?
It really depends on the circumstances. Are there security cameras? No, I'm just kidding. it depends on the circumstances, but getting back to my broader point, you know, I really do think that the majority of problematic violence in this country and around the world is a question of maturity. And I define maturity three ways: self-awareness, general self-awareness, empathy, and impulse control. And a lot of the violence that occurs, that I'm talking about, it's nature nurture in the sense that you're dealing with young men who have prefrontal cortex damage. So they have a bad sense of impulse control, a bad sense of empathy, and they don't make those kind of decisions. Like, kids are like, you tore my poster or looked at my girlfriend, and that's a life or death situation because I need the only currency I have, since I didn't have a father teach me what it means to be strong, which is status. And we're going to fight over something stupid. But once you get past that, and that requires fathers and or mentors, and as jiu-jitsu coaches, we can do that for kids when they come to us. Once you get past that, you're kind of smart enough as an adult to know I should just walk away from the situation. And the people who are going to be more likely to walk away from that situation are people like us who train, right? I mean, we don't care if you walk away. And, you know, you're in the gym every day training with people who actually can fight, who are trying to beat you up, right? It's like, I don't care about this guy. But for somebody who has no training, that could still really be an issue. And pretending like it's not an issue, which a lot of people do, isn't helpful. Like, a lot of men find it necessary to, you know, to be able to defend themselves that way. And they would feel like shit to walk away from a fight. And let's be honest, a lot of women wouldn't be interested in a man who would. We're animals. We evolved that way. But through training and through real confidence gained through that training, we get to a point in our lives where, yeah, got kids, this guy's this idiot, and we can all just walk away. But that doesn't happen because some teacher tells you that's the way it should be. That happens because you train hard, and you know, and you put the time in, and you really feel it inside that you can walk away, especially with kids. But more often than not, with kids, I tell them to actually fight. I mean, if it's a bully situation, the best thing to do is just beat them up and get it done. I don't care what the school says. Get it done with them, and they're fine for the rest of their time in school. And the beautiful thing about jiu-jitsu, I've never had one of my students hurt a bully. They dominate him, right? But they don't have to punch him in the face or gouge their eyes or anything like that.
I think it was Sam Harris who first made the point that Brazilian jiu-jitsu does what Aikido only claims to do.
Right. Yeah, you can control someone without hurting.
You've got more. Keep them coming, man.
I've grappled for many years, and a few occasions we've pretended to have a mind. Mm-hmm. Totally messes up everything I do.
Right.
The fact that Ben probably has a knife, you probably, I mean, everybody, I mean, a knife isn't a big deal. So any fight that I'm going to be in, I have to assume that there's probably at least one knife involved, maybe even my own. How much does a knife mess up all my grappling training and my
knives are very dangerous. It's one of the myths, that one of the problems with people who don't have an understanding of violence or what certain tools can do, and these are just tools, guns and knives, and anything's a weapon if you hold it right, as my friend Paul Sharp says. But I've had situations where news articles and things, and I I've had people, very well-intentioned, intelligent people say, why didn't the officer just shoot to wound him? Why did he have to shoot him this way? He just had a knife. And like, he was 6 feet away. And like, you have no idea what someone with a knife 6 feet away can do to your life if they just happen to hit the wrong spot and you're dead. But interesting story I'll tell you quickly about, man, terrible time. Like 15 years ago, I went to the UK and first met my friend Carl Tanswell, who's one of my black belts, the coach of Saul Rogers, by the way, who's kicking butt on the Ultimate Fighter this season. But Carl had been stabbed. Carl came from a family, a very famous gangster family, infamous gangster family in Manchester, United Kingdom. And he had been stabbed and working on the door 7 times, twice in the head, 5 in the body. They were trying to kill him. And he had come to the conclusion at that point, he, like me back then, 15 years ago, he had been teaching Filipino martial arts and realized pretty quickly that was all nonsense. And he wanted to figure out, is there a way for me to really defend it if somebody's just grabbing me by the back of the neck and pumping the knife in, which is how knife attacks work, right? It's not like this, but somebody just grabs you and starts sticking you as many times as they can, short time frame, as you see in prisons. And so he problem solved. He did what a good scientist would do. He grabbed his buddy and he grabbed some training knives and he worked it through. And he'd been doing this. He'd been working on this for months. So the first time I met him, I show up in Manchester. He tells me the story. He shows me his scars. And he said he'd come up with a solution that worked and that guys weren't able to get him. And I was very skeptical. Like, oh, come on. I've seen all that stuff we've done. We've done it with magic markers and you wind up with black lines all over your face. And so we went upstairs and tried it, and he'd actually figured it out. He actually had come up with something. And it's one of those things, like I said, it's common sense in retrospect, but it's a two-on-one. Like, what do you do when you really want to control one limb in wrestling? You use a two-on-one because it gives you maximum control. There's no better way to control one arm, right? So he goes right to the two-on-one with the assumption that you'll feel the knife before you see it, because that's usually how stabs work. He goes right to the two-on-one, and then he just practices, and he has different moves and things he does from there, but it's all based on, you know, live skill on the two-on-one, and it works. I brought him to the States and put him in a seminar filled with, you know, gnarly, you know, tough guys, and we tried it, and it's beautiful. So.
Now, did you put him up against a Kali master?
So, for some of us who are interested in learning, but we're in Wichita, Kansas, we don't exactly have a large selection, how do we learn? I've been to multiple gyms for kickboxing, and exactly what it is, I shoved him in his punch bag, said, okay, did you ever run for this? He walked away. 10 minutes later, he had to do 2 minutes left for this, and that was the training. How do we teach ourselves if we want to learn to fight?
I would suggest to you Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, because if you're going to be in a fight, it's probably going to be grappling. And I would suggest you find a good BJJ gym. I know there's some around here, and try it out and see if you feel welcome, see if you're comfortable, see how they treat you. Trust your instincts. If anything feels weird or doesn't feel comfortable, don't go there. But if you have a positive experience and it feels good, then I would steer you in that direction. We teach all of it at my gym. We teach stand-up and MMA and all that. And when people come in, oftentimes they'll say they want to do stand-up. But most people who want to do stand-up have never been hit. And they don't really want to do stand-up. They want to learn how to defend themselves. And we kind of try and gently guide them into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu just because I think it's healthier for your body, too. You know, it's the only combat sport that we can all do when we're 50 or 60 and not be crippled. Like Muay Thai fighters, they have a very short lifespan. I don't think I've ever met a judo person that had both kneecaps or wasn't missing a shoulder or something. And it's brutal, but jiu-jitsu, when it's done right, can be good for you. So that would be my suggestion for you.
I agree with you on the premise that the practicality of a lot of traditional martial arts aren't really effective
right. When
you get into a fight. But is there any practicality before you get to that point in your life? Does it have a purpose for small children or maybe adults that maybe aren't comfortable with the idea of, you know, grappling with another person, you know, is there benefit for those martial arts for people, or is it all just a complete waste of time?
I think it's a complete waste of time, but of course, kids in a martial arts class can learn so much, even if it's not a ridiculous martial art, because they're moving and they're exercising and there's other kids and there's socialization that occurs, and so all that's there. I just don't know why it needs to be attached to something that's make-believe. But having said that, there's always there's two risks. There's multiple risks there, but one of them is the development of bad habits. One day down the road, you might decide you actually do want to be able to defend yourself. And you will spend time working stuff that's actually counterproductive. So that's one thing. The other one is, if I see a snake on the ground and I don't know whether it's poisonous or not, that's one level of danger. I see a snake on the ground and I'm sure it's not poisonous, but it actually is poisonous, that's a whole other level of danger. And thinking you know something you don't know is a lot more dangerous than knowing you don't know it. And that's so often what happens in those martial arts. And one of the beautiful things about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, or any combat sport, really, but is you learn, more important than what you can do, you learn what you can't do. And you get a real sense for what you're capable of and not capable of. It's based in reality, and that's healthy for people. If you can get that without getting hurt, why would you not do it?
You mentioned before the important role of the fathers in mentoring sons, and I'm a son and a father, two boys. Is this a role that I step into naturally, or does it happen automatically, or can I screw this up?
Are you dead?
I'm dead, or
no, are you dead?
I have four kids, two boys.
Yeah, nobody. I have four kids. Nobody gives us a manual, right?
Right.
Do the best you can. Learn from experience. It's just when I talk about that, that really came from my from the data. So the first thing I did when I decided I wanted to write the book is I read a lot of what was on the market. I also just went straight to the data. And you have multiple places where it's kept. You have the Bureau of Justice and Statistics. You have the FBI. You also have the CBC. A lot of people will have different issues with the way the FBI catalogs numbers. CDC catalogs deaths by everybody in custody. So you get a good handle on it. And you look through and you start looking at the graphs, and there's certain things that just jump out at you. And the first one, like I said, is men. It's men. Like, violence is a male problem. It's 95%, 90%, depending on what crime you're looking at. Second thing is age. It's almost, the graphs, you'll see almost nothing, and then you hit 15 to 22, and it's like that. And then it starts to drop off tier, and then by the time it gets to 35, it's almost non-existent with all violence. And so then you start looking at other factors, and you can control for unemployment, and you can control for household income, and you can control for education, and still see dramatic discrepancies in the data that are hard to explain. But the moment you start matching it up with out-of-wedlock birth rates, it fits perfectly. And when you talk to the police officers that work in the neighborhoods, or you see the actual statistics, the majority of people in prisons, the majority of people getting arrested, the majority of people committing violent crime are young men that come from fatherless homes. And it's a really controversial thing to say for various reasons, but it's just the truth. Now, how do you fix that? That's a bigger problem that my book doesn't address. People will come to it from different areas. But I think that you can't replace dads with cops and expect to have good results. I mean, they're doing the best they can to try and help everybody, but you know, they can't do that job. And so that's where having people that mentor those young men become important. And I think martial arts schools can play a role there. One of my first black belt from my gym, Travis Davison, moved to Kalispell, Montana. He has a very successful gym there, has a huge kids program, and it's a small town, and some of those kids come from that demographic, the troubled demographic, and I know they're better off because they're in his program, you know, because in many ways he serves as an example, as a role model to me, what it does mean to be a man, and what it doesn't mean to be a man. And so we can do that, but we can recognize the problem. I don't know if that answers your question, but I don't, I, what?
Just just want to follow up one question is that, is it as simple as saying that if I want to make a difference to someone who say isn't my child, hypothetically, it is simply enough for me to just try to take on that role, or do people who are trying to fulfill that role as a surrogate need some sort of additional knowledge to be effective at it?
That's, I don't feel necessarily comfortable answering that, and that's way beyond my expertise, but I would say that from my experience with my own kids and teaching kids and dealing with kids, just time. If you just spend time with them, it's really all they need. Just spend time with them and be honest. And for so often, that's what they need. Just being there and being around them and talking to them and being there if they have something they want to talk to you about, being a presence in their life in the sense of spending quality time with them, makes a huge difference. That would be my answer.
Thank you.
For somebody that isn't interested in a full-blown training program but does want to learn some basic techniques for self-defense, what factors should you look at in a program that might be available in your area?
I think that the main thing you want to develop is, well, first I encourage you to read. So I have you read Gavin DeBecker's stuff, at least until my book comes out, make sure you have it. And then I think you want to put in perspective, like, what is it you're really trying to develop? And then you want to develop a sense of assertiveness. You want to develop the ability to communicate with people your boundaries very clearly. You want to be able to be aware when you're instincts are going off, and you want to honor those and be able to communicate those out loud to people. And then you want to develop a sense of physical confidence, of feeling of what it feels like to have somebody grab you and try and throw you down to the ground or hold you down or choke you. And I hate to be a broken record, but I always think Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is the way to go with that. But it doesn't have to be. I mean, it could be judo, it could be wrestling, it could be a well-run striking class. But you want that physical contact with other human beings. You don't want the first time you feel that to be when somebody has bad intentions and they're coming after you. And so that information combined with that and just being in good shape, I think that's way more important than a particular kick or gouge the eyes here or hold your keys a particular way or any of that stuff. And people will see that in you after a amount of time, and they will not pick you, more or less. They will not pick you. They'll pick somebody that doesn't have that.
Would you say that most of the programs teaching those, now we're going to, put you up against the wall and choke you, that's not an alive choke. That's not how someone's really going to grab you.
So let me phrase it like this. If I had a choice and I could send a young woman who wanted to learn that, and I could send her to a traditional martial arts school or join a female rugby league, I would send her to rugby. Because what I'm talking about is physical contact. When you're like a wrestling team, it's that physical sense of what it feels like against somebody who's not letting you win, and trying to push you around and grab you. That's more important than any of the street, quote unquote, street techniques we could talk about. So,
do you think, like, in a little bit more broader sense, not just like a violent situation or a fight or anything like that, do you think when you're in a survival situation, it really kind of boils down to the will to survive?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. At that point, it's don't quit. You're going to go home. And by the time it gets physical, I really do, I think most of my friends who are experts in this field would say the same thing. I really do encourage people to fight. Don't cooperate. First of all, at any level, you never get in a car with somebody. People who get in cars are just going to secondary crime scenes because they don't want to hear you scream. That's why they're putting you in a car. Even if they have a gun on you, you run. Like, they're most likely they're not going to shoot you. If they do shoot you, they'll probably miss. Most of them suck. Of course, if they do hit you, it's probably not fatal. And even if they do hit you in somewhere fatal, our success rate in this country, because we have so many people getting shot, is fantastic with gunshot. Like, emergency room nurses are fucking amazing with gunshot wounds. So the odds of you surviving are very, very high, right? By running away, even if they shoot you. get in the car here and they have a gun, you're dead. They want to tie your hands up. No. It doesn't matter if they have a gun. They want to put you in the basement. No. These are just things that you just, you don't do. So like once it becomes that point, you understand, now I have to make a choice. The line in the sand has been crossed, and you should, in that case, fight. You just fight as hard as you can. That was the point.
Would you say that if you haven't thought about those, if you haven't given any thought to those kind of scenarios ahead of time, that when the moment happens, you, whether it's through fear, panic, confusion, you're going to trust the promise of the psychopath? And, you know, when they say, come with me, and everything's going to be, you know, like, I promise I'm not going to hurt you. I just want everybody to go down to the basement. That people want to believe those promises.
Sure. They want to believe those promises, but they should not believe those promises.
Sure, but if they haven't thought about these situations ahead of time.
No, I think that's very important. Pre-need decision-making, I think, is how William April explains that. But I remember a story Hickson told me, actually, a long time ago. We were talking about this, and he was telling me how he was completely unafraid to step in the cage or with any man, no matter who it was, which was probably true at the time. And but he was scared to death of a 14-year-old with a gun. And I immediately understood what he was talking about. And he's from Brazil, and he understands what actual violence is as well. And he had thought about in those situations, and he thought, well, at what point would I fight, at what point would I not fight? So if a 14-year-old with a gun shows up and he wants my wallet, he can have my wallet. He wants me to do whatever, he can have my watch. He wants to put my wife in the car, then I'd rather get shot in the head than have her get in the car, because I wouldn't be able to live with myself afterwards. So therefore, that's my line in the sand. I already know that's my line in the sand, so whatever occurs, then it's going to kick off. And he thought about it. He made a logical decision, and that was what he'd come to, and it made absolute sense. Yes, sir.
You have made several comments about fire.
Yeah.
I haven't heard a comment, and I'm sure it's in there somewhere. I've studied Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu about injuring someone. I don't know if you're familiar with Tim Martin's third focus training. A whole premise of what he's done, former Navy SEAL, is creating an injury. Because if you create an injury, the physical body responds to that. And at that point, you have the opportunity to create another injury. And the illustration he uses is the bison video. Everybody that's seen that video, no matter how many times you see it, your stomach kind of curls when that leg snaps. If you do that to another human being, that's creating an injury. Well, what's your concept and belief in that regard?
That's actually really hard to do. It's very hard to do. Let me tell you a funny story. One of my old boxing coaches trained Randall Tex Cobb. Most of you, I think everybody here is probably too young to remember Randall Tex Cobb. But when I was a boy, Randall, do you remember him? He fought Larry Holmes for the heavyweight title, right? He's most famous because he's an actor, and he's ugly, and he always plays bikers. So he was the biker in Raising Arizona, right? That's Randall Tex Cobb. Anyway, he went 15 rounds with Larry Holmes, who on his worst day when he just woke up from a nap, and kind of not even awake, and goes like this with his left hand, will hit harder than I will ever hit with anything. He went 15 rounds with Larry Holmes, and Randall doesn't have defense. Like, Randall didn't slip punches. Randall's defense was his face. So he went 15 rounds. He didn't get knocked down once. He, of course, lost a unanimous decision and took a terrible beating. But what do you do when Randall takes Cobb? So my boxing coach told me a story about him. One day he pulled up at 7-Eleven, and his ex-wife's boyfriend, so I don't know what it was, but there was some dispute, and he was getting out of his truck and walking in 7-Eleven, and all of a sudden his truck pulls up, and these two guys run out with bats, and one of them swings full on and hits Randall in the back of the head with a baseball bat, and Randall took a run and grabbed it and knocked them both out. So what am I going to do to injure Randall Tex Cobb? But the moment I put a choke on Randall Tex Cobb, no matter how much crack he smoked or methamphetamine he's on that day, before I count to three, he's going to pass out. So controlling your body in space and being able to cut off blood or airflow in people's heads, way more reliable than trying to create major bodily trauma that's going to get them to stop. The second thing I'm going to tell you is that all police officers and first responders in general, you know, paramedics and people who pull up on scenes will tell you endless stories of people with eyeballs hanging out and their arm was cut off and the guy's got a golf ball, a golf club sticking out of his head from a brother, a fight with his brother-in-law or whatever. They don't know. They don't feel it. They don't even know what's going on. They get taken to the emergency room, put on a bunch of drugs, and they're like, oh, my ear's missing. You know, adrenaline can make you do amazing things in terms of human injury. So the least reliable way to take out another human being is through major bodily trauma or knockout. It's just not something that most of us can ever count on predictably. But being able to manage distance and control our bodies in space in relation to their body and put ourselves in a place of leverage where we can ultimately make them go to sleep, that's actually easier.
Do police and military get suckered into this kind of stuff frequently? I mean, it seems like I see just on just different police, you know, whether it's their Facebook page or just websites that they're doing some kind of, you know, whether it's pressure points or Sistema or...
Not the police, but on my Facebook page.
I mean, I don't know, it just seems like would it be true to say that just because the police and or military are training something, that does not mean that
it's functional? No, of course. I was 11 Bravo in the military back in the late 80s. I learned nothing about hand-to-hand combat. Now, since then, they've learned a lot, mostly because of the experience in the wars, but also they've had a Gracie Jiu-Jitsu curriculum, I think, for, I don't know, 15
years. Basic.
Gracie Jiu-Jitsu? Yeah. So they have something, but yeah. You know, Ray Price, one of my black belts, for years taught at the police academy, and he'd be the first to tell you that they don't have the time. Like, they have a very limited amount of time they can work with the officers, and most of those officers, once they have that and go on to do their job, unless they take it upon themselves to train and actually train in school, many of them do, but unless they do, that's it. Like, that's the sum total of...
You'll see three officers who have no idea how to control a person.
Yeah, and you know, the guys like Ray and Paul and many of them have been tirelessly advocating to change that, but it's an uphill battle because you're dealing with bureaucrats in there, and you're also dealing with city attorneys who are desperately afraid of lawsuits and haven't quite realized that the last people that are going to injure somebody else are going to be the people who actually train.
Right,
the people who hurt other people on accident are people that haven't had the appropriate training.
Other questions?
Sure.
Let's do it.
We talked a little bit about being able to damage or injure somebody quickly, and assuming that may not work for you. It's probably not safe to assume that I can't be damaged before I even realize that there's a confrontation going on. And how that's going to affect what happens in the coming of seconds. Does that make sense? Like, it's not so much a fight, but more of an attack that before I realize I'm in something, I've already had some major damage under me. And is there any way we can prepare other than trying to figure out how to avoid situations and to deal with that sort of pain and that sort of...
Well, that's where being an athlete is really important. If all of a sudden you're injured and hurt and you're in a fight, what's going to take over at that moment is going to be everything you do in the academy. So if you train with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, you're going to go right into that. It's going to be, you know, and that will happen, but how your body handles it is how well have you taken care of your body. And the athletes and people who train like athletes always have an advantage there in terms of coming out a little less injured, hopefully. I mean, there's not a lot you can do if somebody comes up behind you and hits you with a pipe or something.
So would you say strength and conditioning training is even more important than...
If you're training any combat sport properly, you're getting a lot. You get a lot of conditioning with it. But if you wanted to just pick one thing and you were only interested in self-defense, I would tell you, and you weren't the type of person who was going to invest years in on the mat learning jiu-jitsu or Muay Thai or wrestling, you know, it takes years. Any combat sport takes years to get skill at. So if you're honest with yourself, you say, look, I'm just not going to do that. I'm just not going to go into the gym and spend 10 years learning how to be a good wrestler. Be in shape, take care of yourself. At least do that much, and you'll live longer, avoid the killer that's going to get most of us, which is heart disease and cancer, at least prolong it as much as you can, and be more prepared for those kind of situations.
Is there any martial art that would be effective for fighting more than one person?
No. Well, my favorite response to that is, because there's always a certain undercurrent of egotism to win on, not you, but when some people ask that question. Because I think to myself, as Hornian has said before, could you fight two yourself? Like, it's always one guy thinking, how am I going to fight multiple people? And I say, well, what if there was two of you fighting you? Could you fight two of yourself? Well, no.
Right, but I'm a commando.
Right. I mean, you know, you can train it and practice it in a sense of footwork. And again, it's distance management. Where's your body in relation to these other people's bodies? And being able to maneuver and do that. But no, so there is no secret martial art where one person can then learn to fight two of themselves. Make sense?
So at the point where you realize that the second person, because you, I don't know, I imagine most of the time you don't, most victims of the type of crime don't realize that there's a second person that's going to help the first person.
Right.
You're in it just to get out. Just to,
yeah, well, you should always try to. But I mean, how do those situations occur, right? Most of those situations are going to be people you know.
Yeah.
Statistically. Like, you're in a room with people you know, and then it becomes that. And if it's not, if it's a stranger, it's a true predator, they picked you. And you know, most of you have been picked just based on your ears, but let's just say they picked you, right? One of them is going to initiate contact with you. And that's which should be your first sign that something's going on. The other one's going to try and tap you from behind, and they're going to kick you right down, take your watch, or whatever they want, right? That's how it works. They're going to initiate the contact with you, and that's the big thing that's going to tell you, hey, somebody's, what's going on here?
Would you say that firearm training is critical for somebody who's taking self-defense seriously, the larger project of self-defense?
Yeah, I actually think that's true. I think it also depends on the situation. To give you an example, I had a woman come to me a couple years ago. Remember what I said about most people are good people and crime is decreasing? So she had cerebral palsy. Very little control, and she came to me, she's in a wheelchair obviously, and asked, you know, what I could help her do, and I said, well, you gotta come to the gym, can you get in and out of your chair by yourself, which she could, and I said, well, I gotta see what you can do on the mat, just like watch how you move, and then I'll tell you instantly what I can teach you and what I can't teach you, what you know, what you're capable of and what you're not capable of. So that's what we did, but in speaking to her, she was telling me she had been assaulted on a regular basis. By that I mean she'd be riding, and Portland's a relatively safe city, but she'd be riding downtown in a wheelchair, so we'd come up and grope her breasts, or knock over a chair and try and rape her. And it's very, at first it's just like, that's very unusual. And then I realized, no, she's the perfect target, right? Because she's in a wheelchair. So, you know, it's not that there's a whole bunch of creeps, it's just that one creep, when he sees her, she's like a creep magnet.
Right.
And, she talked about firearms, but I was worried about her ability to control it. And what's she gonna do if she can't control the gun while it gets taken away from her? So my answer for her was a dog. As soon as she gets a well-trained shepherd walking alongside her, that's not gonna happen. Those guys, the kind of guys that would come up and grope a woman in a wheelchair, aren't gonna have anything to do with a dog. And so I hope that's what she did. But that's an example of what I'm talking about. It's very hard to paint with a broad brush and say, well, real self-defense is about guns, is it? Real self-defense is about, is it? I mean, there's individual circumstances that need to dictate the tactics that we use. And in her case, I think really, that might not have been the best option.
Is there a way you feel that you're able to instill that idea of or confidence of fighting? Because you said a lot of times that, you know, the best scenario is to fight. You know,
if it gets to that point, not to be the jerk that is instigating everything, but when you get to that point, you know, how do you kind of mentally switch from, like you said, all of us being generally good people to that person that has to inflict harm on somebody else to protect yourself? Because that's something that a lot of people aren't willing to do.
I hear that, but I don't believe it. I've had a lot of women tell me that. I'd never be able to hurt somebody. I said, well, what if they were trying to rape your kid? Oh, I'd rip their eyeballs out. I'd make them eat their own feet and all that. And it's, no, you have it inside you.
Look, I mean, how do you bring that to that point? Because Well, in a situation, we will react. Like you said, the yep. person will charge the government. The mother will lift the car off the child. Right. You know, instinct and adrenaline will kick in, but not every situation gets you to that, you know, fight or flight response internally. So you don't need to recognize you're in a spot.
You don't need to be in fight or flight to fight. And it would be better if you weren't. I mean, violence is always done better coldly. One of the skills we look for in our athletes that is just their ability to stay calm when they fight. I mean, we all know that's the mark of a great athlete. Conor McGregor will talk. Watch him next. He's going to talk to the guy the whole time. And I promise you, he's calm. And if you look at, would be a good jiu-jitsu example. Any of them really, Rafa Mendes, his expression never changes. Right? So I don't think you need to worry whether or not you draw up this adrenaline. I think that'll happen anyway, because it's actually very unusual to be calm in those circumstances. That's why it's one of the qualities that they need to be a champion. It's rare to be. Most people, the fight or flight will kick in whether you like it or not. And I also don't think you should necessarily worry about that you wouldn't be able to do it, because if it's somebody, if they're hurting somebody you love or kicking a baby, I mean, that's the ultimate argument with a pacifist. It's like, well, okay, so you're driving down the street and you see someone kick a baby, and somebody goes, well, that's never happened. Actually, it has. Violence never solves anything. It does if somebody's kicking a baby. But I think that you'll be able to draw on that by yourself. I don't think that's too much of an issue. But coming into a healthy relationship with the subject of violence is what I want people to do. And combat sports are the best vehicle I know for being able to do that physically. And it doesn't even have to be a combat. So like I said, rugby is rough enough. But that is a vehicle to be able to come into contact with that. And I think it's healthy for everybody to have some of that and some experience with that. And that would be my at first I would tell you not to worry about it. If it was a necessary situation, I think you'd have it within you to do it. And the reason I say that is you wouldn't be sitting here and did, because a lot of your ancestors killed people and did that because they had to. So I think that you have that within you. And the best way to come into a healthy relationship with that is not to repress it and demonize it and not to romanticize it and glorify it with, you know, Hollywood Rambo movies and the whole where it gets silly, but to actually come into contact with it through combat sports.
So my ancestor did have that, but I haven't needed to kill somebody. So given the extremely low likelihood that I'll be personally attacked, how do I justify any amount of effort, thinking and planning and training for self-defense?
Well, you don't have to. I mean, you don't have to plan ahead for it.
I agree.
The numbers are in your favor, I guess.
I mean, statistically, it won't be a problem for you. But if it does become a problem for you, then you might regret that decision. I'm not somebody that's going to sell based on fear. Crime is decreasing. If you're mature and you're not hanging out with a lot of people who are under the age of 35 and doing dumb things, and the odds of you getting into a physical fight are very low. The odds of somebody, you know, trying to kick your door in and kidnap your kids are very low. Those things are very, very, statistically very, very low. Does that mean I don't think it's, does that mean I don't think it's worthwhile to come into touch with that part of yourself and that aggression? No, I absolutely think it is. And I think it'll manifest itself in other ways if you don't, personally. But I'm not going to tell you need to do that in Kansas and the United States in order to stay safe. I wouldn't be telling you the truth. You really don't, as long as you watch where you're going.
Maybe playing off of the last question a little bit, is the severity of the possible consequences, does that come into play when we consider, I mean, statistically it is very low likelihood that any of us are going to encounter violence in a real world setting. But if we do, I mean, the potential for that to go really wrong, really bad, does that begin to maybe even those scales out to make preparation a little more attractive?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, the ramifications of the potential weigh into the decision. Also, who are you responsible for? If you're only responsible for yourself, that's one thing. Are you responsible for your children? Do you have young children with you certain times? Are you responsible for your wife or your family? You know, many of us do have kids and families, and just as I feel responsible to put a roof over my kids' heads so that they're safe and to put food on the table so that they can eat and to be there to raise them, so feel a responsibility to keep them safe. That's part of my responsibility. So, but at the same time, you know, we don't have to get carried away with that and sell our message based on fear. We just talk about, you know, the reality of violence and what the truth is about actual threats.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Did you have a question?
You have to now.
Yeah. You raise this hand.
So, for those of us who aren't necessarily on the path to becoming masters of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in the next 25 years of life, and you say, everybody says, the most important part of self-defense is avoiding the possible need for your self-defense training. Mm-hmm. What can we do, or what would you recommend that we do outside of just normal day-to-day life that will allow us to have better tools to assess any situation as to whether or not it's becoming something we need to get away from so that we can get away from it a lot sooner than, you know, allowing it to become something that would be violent?
Right. First, you have to read my book. It's a process of education and knowing what to look for, understand what the actual threats are, understand what is the actual truth about the likelihood for you of assault, homicide, and those types of things. Where do they occur? Who does them? And then understanding how those people gain access to your life and being able to develop boundaries where you both spot those people and get rid of them. And like I said, most of them will know you. Most of them will know you. And being able to see them, what I call character disordered individuals, and recognize the traits that they have, which is primarily manipulation and a failure to listen to your boundaries. Recognize it for what it is, that they're not misunderstood, that they're a threat. And then be very comfortable getting people like that out of your life. And then being able to see that outside on a regular basis, being able to spot when those kind of things are going to happen. Be able to talk to people. Being able to have conversations with strangers and people. You know, one of the things that people always tell kids, don't talk to strangers. It's a terrible advice. Kids talk to strangers all the time. What you need to do is you have to teach kids how to talk to strangers and who should talk to them and who should not talk to them. But it's also true for adults. And be able to engage in a conversation with somebody that you feel might be testing you. They're going to threaten you, but not so overtly at first. Just in a little bit, just to see you defend your boundaries, to see if you're going to be a good potential victim for them. Be able to communicate with somebody like that without having to go overboard. Be able to recognize them for what they are, put your line in the sand, so to speak. That in and of itself is enough to make most of them just go away. They're not looking for somebody that's going to fight back. Make sense?
So I'm not rude, I care about self-defense.
That's what I tell myself.
Yeah. Is there more questions, or?
Sure. You've mentioned BJJ or Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu several times. Somebody's never even thought about it. What would they expect the first day walking into class? Is it some crazy thing where people, obviously if you're saying this for self-defense, people are pretty rough, it's going to be incredibly violent, I'd imagine. why would somebody go do this type of training? And if I'm not going to be getting advice, how would it help me?
My general thesis with violence is that whether people want to acknowledge the role that it plays in our lives or not, it's there. Right? It's there. It nothing, with the exception maybe, and I emphasize maybe, of sex, procreation, there's nothing that's more closer woven into our biology. And I've had conversations with women who I've expressed the fact that they're attracted to it and they're offended by that. but some are. Have conversations with men who try and deny that it's an issue for them. And I explain, actually, it kind of is. And they might be offended by that. And it can manifest, like any other really deep, primal thing, it can manifest itself if it's not given a healthy outlet in very inappropriate ways. And it can, like the repression and denial side of it, or the voice speak side of it, where people make a fetish out of it. And Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is one of those activities that helps people come into a healthy relationship with it that is neither extreme, but just a healthy relationship with your own body and what it's like to be physically in physical conflict with another human being in a way that's safe, if it's a good school, a safe, productive, beneficial. People learn how to have better relationships, better control over their emotions, better impulse control. All kinds of things come as a result of training jiu-jitsu, or any, you know, I use jiu-jitsu a lot just because it's what I love and what I do, but any combat sport like that. And so I think it's great for everybody.